Life in the military is supposed to be about pride and honour. We respect the men and women whose job is to protect us. But what happens when the protector turns predator? Tonight we reveal how the Air Force failed to stop an abuser in their ranks, a sergeant who terrorised women and children for more than a decade. He was finally brought to justice by his own daughter. But Karina Andrews isn't stopping there. She's determined to change the Air Force culture for the better. With a Sunday exclusive, here's Jahan Casanada. And just a warning, this story does contain some confronting material.
I grew up not knowing who Karina was. She may look happy and she may look smiley, but she is not real. She's just very, very good at putting on a face. And she's using a lot of energy to do it as well. The only thing that she can do is pretend.
But not anymore?
No. The person that you see in front of you is the person that is going to change the system.
Its heyday is long gone, but Hobsonville was once a busy defence base and home to Karina's family.
My dad was in the Air Force.
This is where we grew up and this is where I spent a lot of my time as a child.
You were always quite sheltered. You had really no idea what the real world was like. I was always a bookworm. I was always very quiet. I was always very inward.
Unlike her dad, Robert.
He was a domineering presence in the house. He ruled the roost. You did what you were told.
Karina was told to keep quiet when her father started touching her.
He always said to me, "Don't tell mummy I did this with your clothes off." It was always our secret.
How old were you?
I was 6 years old. Six. I felt like I was doing something wrong. I felt like it was my fault. I was afraid that if I told, that they would take me away. Not him, me. I loved my family, so I wasn't going to tell anybody. When I was 11, that was when the first rape happened. And I never saw myself the same after that. There was always something broken in me. What I know now is that my dad was not just offending in the home, he was offending at work as well. At work, my dad's nicknames were Groper Roper and Robert Raper. If you had somebody working in your department with those kind of names, would that not set off warning bells?
A warning bell did ring when a young woman accused Roper of attempted rape. Military police came to ask Karina what her dad was like at home.
He was accused of the sexual crime, and I couldn't say anything because he was there.
Do you feel safe with your father? Has he ever done anything you weren't comfortable with?
While we were being interviewed, he was behind me. If he wasn't there, I would say something, I would tell them. But he was standing behind me and the pressure of his hands on my shoulders just was tighter and tighter and tighter.
The inquiry went no further.
Was he punished?
No, he was promoted. 10 days after the complaint was closed, he was promoted. Because they didn't charge him, because they didn't look into it properly, he was allowed to keep offending.
So Karina's abuse continued.
I remember waking up in the morning in pain. I remember the blood on my underwear. The fear was just, it was overwhelming. This was my father. This was the man that was meant to protect me. He was meant to be the one man in my life that I could count on. And he was none of that.
What about your mum?
She was a very giving, loving person, but she had no idea what was actually going on. Every day he was at me, sometimes twice a day. And then there was the nights. I didn't know how I was going to survive. I had nowhere to go.
Then another rape complaint, this time from a 12-year-old girl. The military police came back to interview Karina.
He was standing behind me, again, with his hands on my shoulders, trapped again. Again, I couldn't say, my God, what he did to her, he's been doing to me for years.
Instead, the complaint was closed.
We believe the Air Force had four chances to stop Groper Roper in his tracks. But that didn't happen. In fact, after one complaint, he was told to keep his hands to himself, but that was it.
If they had done their jobs correctly, then there would have been a lot of women that wouldn't have been hurt. A lot of people see this as the adult I am, but they don't really understand what the child felt.
2 decades on, Karina's memories are still raw.
What's it like being back here after all these years?
I'm feeling pretty much cracked, like some of the windows, very decrepit, like some of the paintwork. Very stripped bare. I feel very stripped bare.
Karina was 17 when her dad walked out, leaving her with the scars of a decade of abuse.
I was always drunk. I was using alcohol to numb the pain. I didn't really have a very high opinion of myself, and I had absolutely no self-esteem.
So how did that change the way you viewed men?
If a man wanted to have sex with me, he loved me. And I craved that. I really craved that. I was always a very confused woman about who I was and what I was worth.
Look, we're coming up to 100Ks.
Until she found a man she could count on. Paul and Karina met on a dating site.
He was honest. He felt safe.
After you got to know her, there was something underneath. There was a scared little girl under there. Karina had told me very early on in our relationship that something had happened between Karina and her father. She'd chosen to deal with it her way.
They got hitched and started a family.
I am so going to be teaching you how to cook.
Oh, lovely. That's great.
My life was frickin' fantastic.
Until Karina's dad walked back into her life for the first time in years. He started drinking at the bar she worked at.
Started getting these flashbacks of what my childhood was like. I mean, I remembered the abuse, but what I didn't remember was the brutality and the cruelty that came with it. And I clicked, damn it, the prick's still abusing me.
This house became her sanctuary and her prison.
I didn't want to go out because I believed that people could actually see into my soul. They could see the damage that was there.
Eventually, she couldn't take it anymore.
I screamed and I yelled, and then I decided that my whole life wasn't worth living.
She raced into the garage, grabbed a claw hammer, started pounding the bench, and then decided to take to herself with the hammer. I was right behind her and literally grabbed the hammer, grabbed her and went, oh shit.
I didn't have anything left. I was little more than a sexual plaything for a predator, and that was it.
And all this stuff started coming out, it was like, whoa, where are we going next?
I needed closure. I decided to press charges against my father. I rang the Pukekohe police station. I was very anxious. I didn't know what was going to happen. I started to claw back my independence. Didn't hold anything back. I told the police that there were others. I named them. I wasn't going to stop until he was held accountable. I didn't actually realise how big a job it was going to be.
Coming up, Karina faces her father in the flesh.
I saw a man whose past had finally caught up with him.
And she puts the heat on the Air Force with the help of a powerful ally.
No, you guys aren't going to be getting away with this.
That's next.
I didn't walk in there with any emotion. I was there to do a job, and I did it.
Karina's job, to expose her dad as a predator.
I testified without any screams. I didn't do it by closed circuit TV. I faced him. I didn't see him as 10 foot tall and bulletproof anymore. I saw a man whose past had finally caught up with him. I was scared, and I'm worried about the jury. How they're going to see me? Am I just a liar? I didn't think I'd be believed because there was no physical evidence.
But she was joined by 4 other women who also accused Sergeant Roper of sexual abuse.
That was a real freeing moment. That was like, okay, I have done my best. I have told my truth. I cannot do any more. It is now in your hands as a jury. It wasn't until I heard that first guilty that I breathed again. Then it was guilty, guilty, guilty. And that was really a defining moment for me. It was like I had won.
Robert Roper was found guilty on 20 charges against 5 victims, including rape and abduction.
If I had one thing to say to women that are watching this that have been through what I've been through, if you can, bring your offender to justice. He got 13 years in prison, and I hope he bloody well serves every damn year of that 13 years. I needed to show him that despite what he did to me, I came out okay. The shame is his, not mine, and I can hold my head up very high.
But a win in court was not enough.
And I decided to lift my name suppression so that I could reach out to other victims of my father.
Cherie, Karina's childhood friend, is also going public.
I don't trust a lot of people. I don't make friends very easily. I'm a loner, and it's all because of what's happened in the past. In the end, I was actually sick of living lies. I knew that I had to do my part to make it right.
Roper's victims became detectives, delving into his defence career.
How many more are going to come out of their woodwork? That's what that's what we need to know.
Just send them a message and see if they come back to us.
We pieced together quite a bit of it, and we found more women.
10 Air Force women who had horrifying stories about Sergeant Roper.
He touched my breast. He ran his hand up my skirt while I was driving him home. He locked me in a tyre cage.
At that time, did they report it?
They reported it to his superior officers. They were written reports. They were verbal reports.
What did the Air Force do?
Absolutely nothing.
I've spoken to one of Roper's former colleagues who says he complained many times about Roper harassing women at work. But his boss told him, mind your own business.
They swept it under the carpet when we were kids. Are they going to do this again? Well, if they are, then we're not going to let them get away with it.
Karina reached out to someone who's been in her shoes.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm good.
Come inside.
Louisa's an amazing woman with a lot of backbone, a lot of guts. She's been an incredible support to us.
It's kind of like me taking on the New Zealand Police Force. These guys have taken on the New Zealand Defence Force. So, yeah, it's huge. The story is absolutely huge.
Louise Nicholas says women haven't been safe in our military for years.
I mean, I've been supporting survivors that are still in the New Zealand Defence Force or who have come out of the New Zealand Defence Force because of the sexual violence that has occurred against them.
But never had she met victims.
It's been a pretty rocky road.
So determined to change that culture.
They were angry. They hadn't been heard, and it didn't matter where they went, the doors kept getting shut.
They wrote to the Air Force demanding a meeting.
I suffered really badly at the hands of one man, but there was an organisation behind that man that could have stopped what happened, not just to me, but to other women as well.
Defence bosses opened an inquiry into the Roper case and have just launched Operation Respect, a plan to crack down on abuse in its own ranks.
I look at that and I say, those women, they got that role in, and the New Zealand Defence Force are listening.
They need to make it a lot safer for their women to report any kind of sexual harassment or abuse. There are still people within the institution who think that women can be treated like that.
Karina says this is not about blame, it's about progress.
And in 15 years' time, I'd like to look back and think, it's so much better, and we did this.
For the many victims of Robert Roper, decades of silence have turned to strength.
Thank you. They are women that are still at different stages of the healing process, but if one of us is hurt, the other's hurting as well. We're family, we're not friends, we're family.
And family has been at the heart of their journey.
The last couple of years have been like a minefield. There's no manual for this. You've just got to support, do what you can do and go with the flow.
Paul believes Karina's ready for a new challenge.
She wants the ability to understand what she's capable of and also help other people that have been through something similar to show them that there is hope.
Now, Karina dedicates her time to supporting others hurt by her dad.
Victims ring and I give advice where I can. When you go to trial, when you go to court, you're into the victim's room. Some of those women have gone on to the police
and press charges against him.
If she can help one person, she's done what she needed to do.
The one person Karina can never help is her younger self.
What would you say to that little girl now?
I'm sorry. I'm really, really sorry. But I would also tell her that even though the road is going to be really, really difficult, the person that's going to be there at the end of it is going to be an amazing woman. That's what I'd say to her.
Yes, she is. And Karina Andrews' actions have already made a huge impact. The Defence Force told Sunday its staff were sickened by Roper's crimes and acknowledged the devastating impact on his victims. While the Roper inquiry is underway, Defence says it's improving its training and processes to prevent harmful sexual behaviour. Police encourage any new victims to come forward. Contact details for police and other support services are on our Facebook page now.